Okay, so we're talking about the production possibilities frontier. It is a way to model, to show in a picture, the different combinations of goods and services an economy can make. So we're looking here at a way of showing, for maybe a particular country, how much meat and vegetables they can make. Now, we're coming back to one of the topics introduced in the introduction, which is this idea that there is scarcity. We cannot have everything. We have unlimited wants, yes, but we have limited resources. And so economics is all about studying the allocation of these scarce resources. And so what we can see then by looking at the PPF is it captures this idea of scarcity. It captures the idea of a trade-off that in order to get more of one good, I have to give up some of the others. So you can imagine then that I could calculate for a particular country some maximum amount of meat they could produce if that was all they did, was produce meat. So let's just put the number or the point right here. And so graphically, getting back to how you read a graph, what a point like this would mean is there's some number of pounds of meat that can be produced when I do absolutely zero vegetables, okay? So all meat, no vegetables. And it also makes sense that I could hypothetically figure out some amount of vegetables that a country could make if all they did is make vegetables and no meat. And then there'd be various points in between. You know, they give up some meat, so we're going to move down this way and move over this way. So we're going to give up some meat in order to get some vegetables. And so what you can imagine is that could mean maybe a point like here, and here, and here, and so forth. So we can keep going down, so we keep giving up meat, and we're getting more vegetables. And if you connected all those points, you would get something like this, which is our production possibilities frontier, PPF. Sometimes it's called, I think, PPC, production possibilities curve. But the idea is capturing that you are showing on the line itself the points that are possible for the economy to make and efficient. I can also make a point like this one in here, or here, or here. Anywhere inside the PPF is a possible point. And any point on the line is also possible. So what is the difference between those two? Well, the difference is if I'm inside the PPF, such as right here, I am able to keep my meat exactly the same level and get more vegetables. And in fact, I can do it all the way up to here. And so that's why we call these points inefficient, because you're not using all your resources to their fullest amount. Once you get onto the PPF, the only way to get more vegetables would be to also give up some meat. And so there you start to see the trade-off. So those points are considered efficient because you have no extra resources not being used. So what you can see then is these points inside the PPF are possible or feasible, but inefficient. It shows that you're not using your resources completely. Maybe you have unemployment, maybe you have unemployment of resources, something like that. And then the last thing we want to look at is the points out here. These are wonderful points of more meat and more vegetables than any of these points on the blue line. However, they're not possible. That's what we mean by production possibilities frontier. It's the most we could make of the two resources or the two outputs that we're looking at, meat and vegetables. Now, let me ask you one last question on this particular diagram. Where would this particular society decide to consume? Would they want to consume here? Let's call that point A. Would they want to consume here? We'll call that point B. Go ahead and call this one C, D, and E. So if those are our five possible consumption points, where do you think this society would actually choose to produce? Most people, when they're asked this question, will go with a point like C, because you see we're getting about, you know, equal amounts of meat and vegetables, and that sounds good. The reason I'm asking this question is all this PPF does is show you what is possible to produce, but it does not on its own tell you what they will produce, because what determines that is something we call consumer preferences. What do the people want? So you can show with the blue line, the PPF, what is possible to produce, but you're not necessarily showing what they would produce or should produce. So, for example, if this country here was actually a society of vegetarians, what do you think they would produce? Do you think they would pick C? No, they'd probably pick point E, because that'd be all vegetables and no meat. So that's just to highlight what we're trying to get across with the PPF, that it's all about production. Okay, so now that we know what the PPF is, I want to talk about something called increasing marginal opportunity cost. What the PPF is showing us is that if we started at a point like this where we're making using all our apples to make apple juice and doing absolutely zero apple pies, then we decide we want to give up some of our apples from apple juice production and move them into apple pie production. And so if we're going to make one apple pie instead of zero, this little distance here, from here to here, is the amount of apple juice production I'm losing in order to get one apple pie, okay? So it's not a lot. We don't lose a lot of apple juice when we make that first apple pie. Now let's look over here. Let's say we were in a situation where we're making four apple pies. So this is how much apple juice production we get when we make four apple pies. And in order to make that last apple pie, in order to take all our apples, give up all our apple juice production and make only apple pies, look how much we are giving up in apple juice production. So up here we see that we have very little amount that we give up, and down here we see we have a very large amount. So you see that it is increasing, hence the word increasing. What is marginal opportunity cost? Okay, well, marginal, again, is additional. So how much additional apple juice do I give up to make another apple pie? And then the opportunity cost is back to that idea that we talked about in the intro. It's the cost of what you're giving up. So in order to get one more apple pie, I had to give up a little bit of apple juice. And when I needed to make one more apple pie, it's still I'm only getting one more apple pie as I move from four to five. But when I move from four to five, I'm giving up a lot of apple juice. So the cost of that fifth apple pie is a very high opportunity cost, and the cost of that first one has a very low one. So graphically, that's what we see here. That's what you get when you have this curved shape of a PPF. We're going to see in just a second that we can have a different shape to the PPF. When it's curved like that, it means you have increasing marginal opportunity costs. Why are they increasing? You can imagine this is a more realistic version than having a constant marginal opportunity cost, because just think about what we're talking about here with apple juice and apple pie. We have a bunch of apples, and apparently we can do two things with them. We can make juice or pies. If you're using all your apples to make juice, you know, you have that maximum amount of juice you can make. When you decide to make that first apple pie, you will take the best apples, the ones that don't have flaws and blemishes, and make the apple pie. And so you probably don't have a lot of waste. But when you get to that fourth apple pie and you're increasing to the fifth, you're having to use maybe the smaller apples or the apples with more problems that you have to cut off. And so it takes more and more apples just to make that last apple pie, which means you're having to pull that many more apples out of the juice production. And so it's the idea that our resources are not homogeneous, they're not identical. And so they're actually better at making some products than others. So when we first start shifting towards a product, we're going to use the best resources. But as we put more and more and more of our resources into that product, we're having to use things that aren't quite as successful. And so it's costing us more in what we're giving up in order to get more of the other one. And that's the idea of increasing marginal opportunity cost. We see here a slightly different looking PPF. We see one that has a straight line. So we were just talking about increasing marginal opportunity cost. This would be a constant marginal opportunity cost. Every time I give up some fish and get some pineapples, it's the exact same amount. So the idea of the opportunity cost is actually the slope of the PPF. And so when we had the curved PPF, we see that the slope itself would be increasing, getting steeper and steeper and steeper as I move this direction. And so that's capturing this, how much additional of one thing I'm giving up to get the other. But when we have a straight line like this here, we give up the exact same amount of fish for every additional pineapple. And so when we get to the comparative advantage, we'll actually calculate what the opportunity cost is. But before we get to that, I want to look at what happens when things change. One of the things that can change is that we can figure out a better way to produce one of the two products. So here we're looking at, this is the idea that you have somebody on a desert island and they need to provide themselves their food, and they can go fishing or they can gather pineapples. If they spend all their time getting fish, they get 10 a day, and if they gathered pineapples, they can get 20. So this is what they could possibly produce, and obviously they're going to try and come up with the appropriate balance for themselves. But what if this is the initial situation, and then the guy figures out how to build a better fishing pole? His ability to produce fish will actually go up. So instead of being 10, let's say it becomes 15, okay? That doesn't mean anything happened over here to pineapples. It just means his ability to produce fish has gone up. So what would happen, give me some luck here that this will work, is that the line would shift just like that. So this still connects at 20, but now it has shifted out to 15. And so you get this rotation around the pineapple number of 20, just one axis shifts. And so when you see a PPF that has done that, that tells you something has happened to affect the production of fish, and only fish, okay? So that is what happens when you have an increase in technology. Another possibility would be that your overall ability to produce everything has changed. So if we come back to the original 10 fish and 20 pineapple, the blue line here, what if you have a population increase? And so that the total amount you can produce of both has grown. And so I'm going to not really have room here, but you can imagine if this was 20 up here. So if this is 20 up here, then we can imagine that our production of pineapples is also doubled, and what we would get is this parallel shift, I guess it'd be more over here, of the whole PPF, so that the entire ability to produce has grown for both fish and pineapples. And so what that is economic growth. So when you see a PPF, and all you see is a pivot around a point like we have here, pivoted at pineapples at 20, and it changed on the fish axis, that's telling you that something has happened in the production of fish. And since it went from 10 to 15, it's telling you something good happened in the production of fish. You've had an increase in your ability to produce fish. That's going to show technology. If you've had some sort of overall improvement in your ability to produce in both goods, you're going to get a whole shift of the line, like the blue to the red, and that shows you economic growth.